Okay, welcome to the planning board meeting for Monday, November 7th, 2016. Thank you to HCAM for taping the meeting. We're short a couple of people today, and they might have to watch the tape, though hopefully not. But we always thank you for taping the meeting, because it's very good that the public gets to see it, too. And thank you to all of our loyal viewers out there that are watching us instead of maybe the election tonight. But anyway, the agenda today is very light. We might get out of here fairly early tonight, which would be great, but that isn't to say that we won't discuss everything we need to discuss. The master plan public hearing is at our next meeting, which is November 21st at 7:30 p.m. And we invite all members of the public and committee chairmen and boards to come in and give us input and suggestions on how the master plan might look a little bit better. We got some very nice feedback from Norman Kamalo, the town manager, when the selectmen discussed it at their last meeting. He was particularly complimentary that basically we ended up writing it ourselves with, obviously, with Elaine and Jen's help, where a lot of towns will spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to kind of do what we did over periods of years. And quite frankly, I think, given it's a local product, it ends up being better too, because one of us would have to probably teach the consultant and tell them what the heck they're going to write anyway. It's, I don't understand that racket, but anyway. Other announcements, voting is open tomorrow, 6:30 to 8 in the middle school gym. Encourage everyone to get out and vote. And with that, I'd like to open the continued public hearing. This is an application for site plan review from Front Point Management, LLC, Western Partners Acquisition Group. And this is 445 South Street, which is a new 10,200 square foot commercial building with parking, etc. And we discussed this at our last meeting and kind of had a kind of an action plan for the engineer to kind of get done, and I know he's been working really hard, and Beta has been working really hard, and quite frankly, it's my expectation that we'll finish it tonight, but we'll see where we go.
I didn't bring my visa this trip, so I'm going to use this chair.
We don't have one?
Wow.
Someone stole it.
Okay. So, why don't we were kind of, why don't you give us a couple minute overview of where you're at,
sure.
And then we had left it where we had kind of talked about the outline items,
Yeah. But
we hadn't really closed them all out because there was an action item on almost every one, and we'll just go right down the
sure. Outline
and then finish it right out.
Okay, Peter Bemis, Engineering Design Consultants, again, 45 South Street. So this is our revised set of plans, and it's a complete set. You would have gotten that in your packets, and there was a cover letter that outlined the items. The first part of our letter was to go through peer review. So I don't have the outline. I have my response letter.
Okay.
Underneath here. Yeah, I see it right there. Right there.
By the way, the plans he's talking about were in front of you today because I think they got changed very recently.
You changed them.
Didn't have to change anything further. There was just the final couple of quick edits we got to Beta last week. So nothing further today.
Okay.
Right, but they came out on Friday.
Yes.
Yes,
and yeah.
They didn't get
them. Oh, yeah, okay. You're not getting them with the email that quickly. Okay, then I'm sorry. Yes, on Friday we had a couple final items. So going through the outline, the third item is Beta review. So
We got through that. We're on item 5, which will be the detailed discussion.
Okay, so I'll go through that. So traffic, we provided you with a traffic memo. That would have been in your packet.
Yeah.
Yep.
That wasn't in a timely fashion. And we outlined what the traffic flow was going to be at the new facility, what it was in the previous facility, and that the abutting use at the existing facility is taking that space and using it for storage. So you will actually see a improved traffic flow on South Street, in my estimation, because this use is moving further south on the street, and you will not see an increased traffic pattern at 25 South Street because that space is just being absorbed for storage. Building design, HVAC units, they are on ground mounted. They're shown on our site plan where they'll be. There's no rooftop screening required for that. For stormwater management, we did have a complete stormwater
Wait a second. Let's just, a lot of times after each item, I normally...
I'll give you a minute then, Mr. Chairman.
I normally ask for a consensus so that we just kind of go through and build consensus item by item.
Okay, you got it.
Everyone had the traffic memo for that. Is there any questions or comments or things that you thought needed to be better, different, or anything on traffic memo? I think he met what our expectations were for that item, and I kind of agree with the engineer's statement that, you know, traffic-wise, we're in good shape with this. Okay, so I'm seeing a lot of nods, so that one we'll consider check marked off on the traffic. Building design, I think he answered the major question that most of us had as to where the rooftop or HVAC units were.
They were ID'd on the site plan, and they're on the layout materials.
And you have some kind of screen around them at all, or
there's
are they
vegetation
just
there.
Some vegetation?
Right.
Okay. Anyone have any other questions on building design? Seeing none, we say that's a consensus. Now, stormwater management.
So in our original design, and a lot of our discussion was really through beta, it was the approach that was being taken. So when we hit a break in the meeting, if you recall, and mm-hmm. I got to meet with Phil one-on-one, and I did not care for how the engineer in my office put together the programming. So we reprogrammed it the way we would any site. This is a redevelopment project. The development area was at the top end of the site. So for stormwater management, what we basically did is we tied everything back into the existing drain system and then mimic what would happen here under pre- and post-development conditions. And we have a complete reduction in flows from this portion of the site by infiltrating stormwater. We had shown you that we were infiltrating stormwater before. It's just, it was the mechanism in which they were putting together the formula to evaluate it. It's a much more streamlined manner in the way we're doing it now. Basically 100% of the rooftop area gets infiltrated, and parking lot portions here get treated and then infiltrated. Small portions of the site then flow off, and we meet that existing pre-development rate of flow. So that was a complete report.
And I think we got in a beta letter, they had all the issues resolved as I went through there.
Yeah, the only outstanding item from beta was the illicit discharge compliance statement, which you just handed me tonight. So.
Okay.
I just had a question on building design. I'm sorry. The building itself, do they have a garage? A lot of this type of business has a garage door where they open it, it's open to the air. Is this particular design like that, or is this?
We do have three loading docks.
I mean to the facility itself, not for the docks. I mean, a lot of these, where they work out with the weights, they actually open the garage doors. I know there's one near where I work. And I was just curious if
there are three. There are still going to be three garage doors in this building design.
Okay.
They certainly could open them.
And they access the actual floor where they're working out, or is this for loading dock space, or?
It's going to be part of the space, so the space planning
so
purposes, it would be open, sure.
Okay. That would be in the back, correct?
But it's in the back, right. Because we're setting this building up for future potential use by other users. It is being specifically constructed for CrossFit. I think my client would hope that they're wildly successful here.
The highway back?
No, face north.
It's this side here, so it's really more north.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, highway's
on the east. And it's not visible, so even if you were at the highway, the site's elevated to the highway, so you really wouldn't have a...
I don't think the visibility is anyone concerned.
That's what I was wondering about, the tenants in the other buildings, if the visibility...
I don't think that anyone's going to
be aimed that way. Okay.
Be adversely affected by that. So stormwater, we had that issue completely reviewed and satisfactory sign off.
Everyone here is happy with stormwater, I assume? usually when Beta is happy, we're very happy.
So parking lot design is item D, 5D, and it's no storage, so we identified what snow storage areas were, and we also had agreed that at a certain point, this site can only support so much on-site snow storage. So then we would be hauling off any excess material if we have excessive stones. The interior landscaping requirement was also evaluated on site, and we do comply with that provision. We actually expanded our landscaping footprint with what we had originally submitted by increasing the planting areas. We prepared a separate fire truck turning radius exhibit that I submitted directly to the fire chief. Went back and forth with some questions and answers.
And we have a memo
an email
from him.
Came back from him. Okay. And handicap parking. So handicap parking with what we had proposed originally was fine in our proposed a new development area. However, what we Beta had brought up was the fact that all of the existing was not. The provisions were there for it, but they moved all of the handicap symbols one space away. So it did not have the 5-foot aisle between the space and the vehicle. So the handicap pedestrian traffic would have been limited. So we've actually shown in the dark print here to reconfigure those handicap spaces and move them back where they were originally. It's clear that that's what the original design had provided. So those were items D.
Okay. Anyone have any further questions on parking lot design? Seeing none, I think we'll close out on item D.
And item E is lighting. So we'll say a little bit of lighting spillage and timing. So as far as timing, we identified that the lights would come on a half hour prior to start up in the morning, and then they would shut down a half an hour post a shutdown in the evening.
And those times?
A letter, and we put the times on too. So it was a 5 o'clock start and
5:30.
Thank you. Yeah, you can probably see it better than me because I'm going to take my glasses off to read it. And we identified each day. So it was Monday through Friday there was a time.
Yeah, that's
there
fine.
Was Saturday and Sunday. Sunday's
Saturday,
hours
7
were.
To 3 and Sunday is 9 to 9.
My past is the eye test here. Yeah. That's great. So that's what the hours were. And then the light spillage was corrected by just adjusting the photometrics and the light fixture. We were close, it's just that we had a little bit of spillage and those were correct.
Does anyone have further questions on lighting? And, you know, this is also right in the middle of an industrial park with a highway going by it at the backside, so.
Not as sensitive as other areas.
So went on to what property?
It was 495. and that's why the engineer in my office thought, oh, this is okay. But Jen was just make it comply. So I basically said, you know, go in and adjust the fixture again.
Okay. Lighting, everyone happy with? Okay. E is checked off.
Yes. So F is landscape screening. So again, we took our plan that we had given you before and we just enhanced it. We've added a lot more deciduous shrubs in between. We actually added a couple more evergreens. And we moved the spruce a little bit because one of the comments from Beta was growth patterns for it. We added some pines along the abutting southern industrial property as well, and then a few up here along Corner and Cottage. And I really didn't have any bad, there was any negative issues on landscaping.
Yeah. I just wanted to, through you, Mr. Chairman, the question about the tree plantings. Are there any in the parking lot area? It looks like.
There are trees that are proposed here. So those are Cleveland pears in our parking space area. Then we've got evergreens along our driveways here between the buildings. And then we've got we've got some perimeter evergreens as well.
Thanks.
And the 10% requirement is the two pieces out front?
Yeah, and then these the fingers up through.
Got it.
And then here. So okay. We're well in excess, actually.
Good. Okay.
And then just as a side note, Jeff Doherty, who's chair of the Design Review Board, had seen Beta's, he had reviewed your package and seen Beta's comments and Mr. Eunice's responses and was very appreciative of the additional landscaping and thought that they were well done. So.
Okay.
We had about 50% more, so okay. It wasn't a keep doubling down, but we definitely have more than 50% more plantings than we can when we start.
Sorry, just one more question related to the trees. The existing building along the parking lot there, I didn't get a chance to see this in person. Is there an adequate number of trees along the parking lot?
Yeah, I mean, it's it's an existing plant that was built a number of years ago, so what's happened is some of that vegetation has grown up quite a bit.
Okay.
But we really didn't focus on that end of the task.
Sure.
I would say that it's definitely a landscape site.
Okay, thanks.
In the north building, and this were, I think, constructed at the same time or by the same owner, and so there was...
Yeah, these were done.
Yeah, they're different owners now. But
right. There's a link between the two sites.
Yeah.
35 and 25. 35 and 45, excuse me. And our owner is 25.
Okay. I'm not seeing too many other questions. Landscaping is okay?
So item G was utilities, and the item was solar. I did ask the owner to evaluate that. I said one of the tenants is a solar company. The determination is basically that the incentives are gone. The federal incentives are gone. There's not really good payback on this at this point. So for them to be able to absorb the added expense for this program, it just doesn't make sense. Again, I think they'll continue to evaluate it. If it makes sense, they'll do it.
Sure. Okay. And I think we had a pretty good discussion of all the other utilities, I think, the last time around with all the undergrounding and sewer
yeah,
water.
Yeah, just to reconfirm, there's no new utility poles going in, correct?
Nope. We changed that note and we went underground from the existing pole. So
thank you.
That comes to the building.
Okay. I'm going to check off utilities. Construction management.
I mean, if you're willing to give a waiver, I drew the plans the way you wanted it, but if you were willing to consider it, I'm sure my client would prefer to waive that.
We're pretty much.
I know you said that to me, so yeah. I took that away as a no.
Yeah.
If you're willing to consider it, I'm going to leave that out there. Construction management plan. So we did identify a sequence that was also in our SWEP.
Which for all the non-acrim, that's a stormwater pollution prevention plan, I believe?
Right. So the key piece to this is, and that's outlined, so this is our stormwater plan. So basically, this plan is how the contractor will exercise his construction programming. And so what has to happen first, basically, is this utility corridor has to be taken care of before we even start building the building, because this building will eliminate the soil absorption system that supports this building. So this infrastructure has to be put in place first. Once that's online, with the sewer connection and the water extension, then this work can go forward. And again, that's all outlined in this whole narrative. And that narrative was set up both as a separate 8.5 by 11, it's freestanding, as part of our stormwater management plan, and then on the plan itself. And the contractor's contract basically is tied to this plan.
Any further questions? Okay, construction
signs. So as far as signs are concerned, what we identified was that we do have a ground-mounted sign at the site. There's no intent for this facility to have a separate sign. So basically, it's a multi-tenant building at 45 South Street. I do believe that at some point they are going to want to upgrade that sign. They'll come in and whatever sign requirements are with your building department that requires a planning department review, you're going to get something separate. You don't want to make a commitment on that at this time as to any new signage. Any building-mounted signage that CrossFit wants to have, again, go through building department. If we have to come back to see you folks, we will.
You won't have to come back to see us, but probably design review before the building inspector. Yeah, but
understood. They just, there was no...
They're pretty friendly sometimes.
Right. I think whatever we do with being...
I don't know about signs, but...
it would be in keeping with what this facility is proposing to do.
Mm-hmm.
Item J, it's okay, item J is dumpster screening. So what we did with that, just We identified where the dumpster was going to go, and it's a full fenced in enclosure, and there's a detail that shows that enclosure.
Where's the detail? I think I missed that.
If I go back to those sheets, there's five or six. It's on one of them.
Right there.
Thank you.
There you go.
There it is. There it is.
It is a, what is it, a vinyl fence?
Yes.
And gates in front?
Yeah. And again, that dumpster can't be seen. But there are trees around it. If you look at our landscaping plan, I mean, we originally thought maybe we could do that, and then we just figured, let's just put the fence around it.
And how high is the fence?
6 foot.
And the Norway spruce essentially going to cover
it? Yeah, I was just going to say, you're not going to see it anyway. Yeah. So.
No, I think it meets better than most.
Yeah.
Okay, dumpsters were done. There was one other question that I got that it didn't make the outline was noise and sound, I think.
If you're going to keep those doors open, you might hear some grunting and groaning, I would think, but there's no special noise that this user will have. Future users for this site, I mean, it's an R&D park area here. I wouldn't expect anyone coming in here with any sort of heavy special equipment and machinery. So I would not say that we exceed any of the local noise ordinances.
And the unit to the north of this is another multi-tenant, I believe, right?
Yeah, that's actually, you would ask that. It's vacant now. And my understanding is that building was a drug manufacturer of some sort, so it's actually got some very high fence clean rooms. Hmm. That's probably why it's still been vacant, is that no one's come along with that use. Okay. It's so fitted out.
So I guess my question, Mr. Chairman, is just for those, not necessarily abutters, but for that building to the west, the sound's coming out of there, a lot of dropping of heavy weights, a lot of sound, you open up those doors, does that tenant have any recourse? I mean, is there anything that would kind of, that they're going to have to go and say, hey, tone that, close the doors
sure.
or whatever?
Sure, I would say that's probably what would happen. I know the solar companies in the existing building, and they have trucks that come into the loading dock, and I don't think they've been there, and I've not heard any excessive noise, so I can't imagine the CrossFit folks are going to have excessive noise. They already exist on South Street at 25, and I don't believe they've ever had a noise complaint. So, I just know the gentleman was concerned about the doors going up, and that's the only thing I could think of is that would be what would happen, is roll a tire out the door or whatever, and then they roll it around the parking lot. Flipping it.
Now,
I've seen them.
Doors there now.
They do have a one bay door in the back. It's usually closed.
Explain this exercise a little bit for me.
You've never seen CrossFit, you should see it.
I need to go over there?
Play loud music or something?
There's music, but it's not loud.
All right. So I can't imagine that they're going to be a nuisance use here, for sure.
Hmm. It's like cardiac rehab on steroids?
Yeah, I think it's on steroids for sure.
The Flintstones.
Okay.
Pretty intense.
I just see the tires. That's the one that gets me, is the
thick
rope, flipping them.
Okay.
Bricks I mean, they're only moving two lots down or three lots down with the same use, so I'm not sure.
Well, if they were making excessive amount of noise, I would think that somebody maybe from the public or the other tenants would have taken this opportunity because they all got notified, and obviously there's not a serious problem. So,
through the chair, if I could just ask a question. This building you're designing, when you spoke of the parking for the handicap, you're basically encompassing the entire parking lot with this. Is that correct? You're going to fix the handicap parking?
The existing building, those parking spaces do not comply with ADA requirements.
Correct. So you're going to repair that. Were there any other repairs that were going to be made to the main building, like for the lighting or any of that?
Just the parking lot. Noted, and there's identifications on the plan to fix any guardrails that are damaged.
Guardrails
and pavement.
And pavement.
So any pavement that's broken up has to be replaced as well.
I think overall it's going to be a better site at the end of the day. Not that it's a terrible site right now either. I mean, it's an industrial flex space.
Pretty much it. It's industrial flex space, and it's a building that was constructed in the 80s. So, it's kind of gone through its life cycle, and it needs some upgrades.
Yeah.
And over time, I'm sure they will.
Yeah.
Question about their guardrails.
It's in the hotel district too.
But are we installing new guardrails?
Where they'll be replaced where they're damaged.
Okay.
We're not replacing
them. Do you know what type they're using?
They're wooden guardrails that are there
excellent.
Today. So they'd be basically, I don't believe any of the posts were bad, but some of the rails were damaged from snow removal activities over the years. So those rails would be replaced.
Well, I'm a fan of the wooden ones, so that's great.
Okay.
Okay, so now we're at the point with public comment. I don't see any members of the public other than the press, so I'm not sure we've got too much comments here. Let's see. Okay, we'll talk about standards and plan revisions, I think. We've already gotten all the plan revisions, got part of it done, and then the site plan standards. I think we can go through Jen's memo on page 3. We go through the standards, and I believe we find either not applicable or comply on all of the standards.
Except for one. M.
Sidewalks.
M. And
sidewalks.
Basically, we have sidewalks on the other side of South Street, I believe. And there's no
on that portion, yes.
And there's no sidewalks anywhere else on the plan. So I don't see any need to provide, you know, just in front of this.
Yeah, I would agree and I would figure as much, but I didn't want to say that without the board.
Is there consensus that we don't want to just sidewalk in front of this guy's place?
Yeah, I'm okay with no sidewalks.
That's
okay.
Why I asked the questions I asked so far back.
And then in item 7, which one time she wrote it, she had the light on it, but now it's complied.
And then number 8 complies as well, because he's adding the timing.
So, since we're all set with conditions, if board members, maybe I'm speaking for myself, but I think we're all set with conditions,
mm-hmm.
or standards, I'm sorry, standards, so we meet that. Then next is conditions of approval. If you want to just come on and sit down here.
No, that's fine. I know you have it on TV, so I didn't want to. Thank you.
We're trying to be friendly here a little bit. The conditions. Did you have a chance, Peter, to take a look at what Jennifer.
I got Jen's draft, yes.
It's gone through there. The conditions are, and let me just go through it, dumpsters on the property shouldn't be emptied before 8 and after 5. Applicant is responsible for mitigating all construction-related impacts, including erosion, siltation, and dust control. The applicant should remove construction trash and debris and not bury anything. I'm paraphrasing what's in the letter. Construction will only occur in basically the hours that are in our bylaw. It's typically kind of an anti-noise for outside. If somebody was painting outside inside that thing and we wouldn't know it, you know. No. 5 talks about the condition for if the snow gets too deep that it has to go somewhere else. And we have the site plan, and I think you wanted to change that to half an hour.
Yeah.
So it'll be a half an hour. And do we meet the 11 p.m.? We want to reword this, Jen?
Well, I would leave the 11 p.m. in case they have, like, a special event or something. I mean,
okay.
We're not open that late, but that would be fine, Jen. I had no problem with Jen's comments. So.
Okay. So, basically...
I would just change 1 hour to a half hour after close of business.
We need to add something in there on opening of the business, too.
Okay, so shall be
off
until one half hour before
prior to
okay.
Okay.
Through the chair.
Yeah.
Should we put in hours of operation? Because it's not a large jump in logic that at some point this might become a full fitness. If they decide CrossFit has passed and it becomes a full fitness facility, and now it's becomes a 24-hour fitness operation. So we put in some type
of... I don't think you can regulate a business operation, hours of operation, legally.
We haven't done that on any of our other bylaws. I mean, and it's not in a residential, it's really far from the nearest residence, so I'm not sure we have to, I don't know, that's my opinion, but I think if we do the half hour open and shut.
Yeah, I think that's to your point, that's why leaving it, your lay shall be on after 11 p.m. If they have to go 24 hours, then they have to come back in and get that changed.
Yep. Okay. Condition 7, mechanical equipment will be screened. According to plan, the dumpsters will be screened. And then the inspection requirements, if we need an engineer, the applicant has to pay for it. We put a performance bond request of $5,000 for that. 99% probability you'll get it back.
Right, and that's fine. The form of that, is it always cash in Hopkinton?
No.
Do you allow?
No,
okay.
We take charities.
You do take
charities? We'll take it however.
Okay.
Just the form has to be approved by town council.
Okay.
And we talk about existing pavement and asphalt berms will be repaired. And then commencement, a site work copy of the SWEP will be submitted to the planning board, which, do we now have that? Or is this assigned one in the whole
thing? We need an official signed SWEP.
Right, that's fine. Yeah, because we don't have a contractor awarded yet, so when I do, I will just forward that to you. But you do have the framework.
We have it, but we just need the contractor to sign that he's aware of
the... Okay, so those are the conditions of approval. Are there any other conditions that board members might think that we missed? Seeing none, sounds like we're in pretty good shape on that. Public comment, is there anyone from the public that wants to comment? I'm seeing none, but we'd be mindful of them if they would, were here. If you read some of our decisions, that's one of my favorite paragraphs, so we're mindful of the public. So. And okay, so we're not going to close the public hearing, we're going to vote first, because I like it that other way.
I know, I always do it. I'm sorry, I always do that wrong.
Yeah. Anyway, okay, so basically, I'm going to entertain two motions. one is that the determine that the site plan complies with the site plan standards except for standard M, which is construction of the sidewalk along the frontage. And to waive the construction of that frontage.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, then entertain a motion to approve the site plan with the conditions that we slightly amended in our discussion earlier, which would be conditions 1 through 12. And I think the major was site lighting times was the major amendment I think we made. So entertain a motion to approve the site plan with those conditions.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, I entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Moved. Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. And you are
thank
all
you
set, all approved.
Appreciate it.
Best of luck with that.
Best of luck.
Look forward to the next one.
We
not
will
being back on this one.
We will, and thank you for working good with the engineer. That all worked out pretty well. And Jennifer, we're going to have this done before Friday. And I'm hoping to have it done, signed by, for sure.
Well, we're closed Friday, so.
Thursday, then.
I'll do my best.
Yeah, because I'm in Boston.
Are you off Tuesday? Is what you're off tomorrow?
No, I'm not off tomorrow. I'm
here tomorrow?
But
okay.
I have a couple meetings and some other stuff. But it's a late day, so I should be able to get most of it done tomorrow.
The kids are off to school tomorrow.
And
thank you very much.
Well,
thank
anyway, you. We'll get the last page done for sure.
Okay.
So, that's our major part on the agenda. We got a couple other fun things. We got a request to release the performance bond for 132 East Main Street, which is the assisted living. I see they have their occupancy permit, and they're all set.
Kobe and I went over and took a tour. And it is a very, very nice facility, and I've already put a deposit down for when I'm
55.
It's a gorgeous facility. They've done a great job.
And speaking of that, I know I've toured the one in Westboro when we were in the process of approving it, and then I took a tour when I was looking for a place for my mom, and I'll tell you, if she hadn't picked my sister, that's where she would be.
Some of the amenities are unbelievable that they have over there. They're really amazing.
Isn't there an opening ceremony for that?
There
already happen?
There's an open house
on Sunday.
Is it this weekend?
Sunday.
Coming up?
So,
yeah. And
Sunday the 13th.
You're all invited. It's open house, so you're all invited. And I sent you the email, I believe.
Yep.
And
11 o'clock, got it.
Unfortunately, I am out of town that day, so Brian is going to represent us. And they're going to have a ribbon cutting, and it's, I mean...
Anyone wants to join me,
you're
more than welcome.
If you want to tour, I give you the guy's contact.
I've got his card.
Okay.
I mean, what they set up is, maybe most of you remember, they have a husband and wife that live in the facility. And the guy that's doing it now, just like the architect was, I've said, most professional people before this board. I mean, this family comes during the construction, and they're interviewing people to it, and until they pretty well get it full, then he goes off and does their next one, because they're building, you know, lots of these things all over the country. I think they're up to 500 or something like that. It's a huge number. It's a family-owned business too, and so this couple, or guy and his wife, you know, they know how to sell the units, obviously, but they also know how to deal with grand openings and, you know, getting it staffed and you know, they're really
operations hands on.
Yeah, it's.
They're also people like we were at least when I we were on two different tours. When I was there, there were people moving in, and he knew everybody by first name, and he was like shaking hands and like, but not fake. Like, they're from the Midwest, so they were so down to earth, and it was so nice and so welcoming and homey, and I was just like, this is a really nice place. Like, you know, it was really, it made me feel good.
Yeah,
like, I was like,
to
I want to live here, because like, I'm not even that age. It was like...
Yeah, don't they cook all the meals for you and
they
everything?
They cook all the meals. They clean your apartment for you. They, like,
I think
do
it's
your
about
laundry
$2,500 of...
The cheapest one. There's studios, one bedrooms, two bedrooms, and I think one 3-bedroom.
And they're kind of like tenant at will, like 1 month notice or something like that, right?
Yeah. Right.
I lied.
Yep.
There's only 2 bedrooms.
Say, what do you do with that third bedroom?
I lied.
Yeah.
But yeah, they have gardens, they have a bocce court, they have grills outside, they have an ice cream machine, they have a theater, they have.
Pool, no pool?
No pool. I mean, it was really nice.
Yeah, it would be great if it wasn't just full of older people.
How old is the oldest person you mentioned to?
82 or 83. And they said the average age is... No, the youngest was 61. The average was 80-something. The oldest was 90-something, yeah.
But this who's living there now, or...?
Or will be.
That's already signed up.
Oh, that's signed up, okay.
Yeah.
No.
I'd be the youngest.
I think it's a great.
School age children, if any.
Yeah, many school age children. Yeah.
Depends what kind of school you're talking
about. So is this Roy's competition?
No, it's the next step up.
Okay.
It is, yeah.
This is what you go from place to place.
You don't even need a car. They have like a big van that will drive you anywhere you want to go, like take you to the store. Like, I love it. I can't speak highly enough on that.
Wow.
Everybody told my parents about it.
Dave, when he came and made the presentation, said, you know, people will come and they'll have their cars when they move in, but within 6 months, they find that they're not even using their cars.
Yeah. Right.
It's great.
Probably not even leaving there that much, right?
Well, no reason to leave. They have these
big welcome tags
on every door that said "Welcome to your new home" with the person's name with these big bows. Like, it was just so cool.
But the lease is only for a month, so
yeah, it's month to month.
You can make a quick decision,
right?
Yeah.
Well, I think that's part of the reason.
Yeah. I get a piece of mail from them every week because I think I'm in their demographic. I also might be in their list because I was looking for it for my mother, too. But
So it's Fairview Estates, right?
Yep.
So we'll be seeing that shuttle floating around town?
You might be.
Going to all the doctors and everything else.
Around the hospital.
And probably to the senior center a lot, too.
Senior center and sure. CVS, Hopkins Drug. And
library, the new library.
Library.
Yep.
Except they had a nice library inside.
Yeah. Okay. Now let's get back to releasing the performance bond, which I think was $5,000.
Yes.
And the only thing that I had a question of, and I don't think that we need to hold up the release of the performance bond, but the strip between the pavement and the sidewalk didn't get finished out on the street side. It looks great on the interior part.
I don't think I was there. I think that was a Roy.
They did it. They did that sidewalk.
Okay, I'll check because I know when. Because that's the sign for the toll house that Claire had put in.
Yeah.
I thought she coordinated with Roy.
I believe we ended up requiring the sidewalk in that area, and then the town is taking care of the sidewalk going further east.
I can double check on that for you.
The sidewalk's on their side.
Yeah.
The south side?
Right. South side of the road. It's just the edge of the pavement, just this wide.
The green belt, right?
The green belt. It looks like it's...
It's not green.
Well, it's not green. There's no way whatever's in there can grow grass.
Right now.
Nothing's green, no.
Yeah.
Okay.
But
kind of like Legacy South. It's not green.
This is a little worse. Entertain a motion to release the performance bond for 132 East Main Street.
So moved. Second.
Moved and second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. The next item, Jennifer, why don't you explain that one? It'll take some pressure off of me for a second.
So, as you know, we issued a special permit for a solar installation at 201 Hayden Rowe to select. And part of that, one of the conditions for that was that they provide a bond for the discontinuance for the life of the project. So they've been working and doing some site work, and they wanted to get a building permit. Before they could do that, they had to get the bond. So I've been working with them and their lawyer, and then they submitted what they anticipated as the cost, which didn't look like enough to me because it didn't include some things that I would have thought should have been included. So I had Beta look at it, and Beta added some things in. Then I sent it to town council for what type of surety we should require, because it was a longer bond than we would normally, because it's the life of the project kind of thing. Well, in that conversation, their counsel came back with, well, we can't get a bond for the life of the project because we don't know what the life of the project is. So there was some negotiation between our counsel and their counsel, and what they came back with, the best we can do is 1 year with a renewal every year. So I expressed some concern to counsel, well, how do we commit that they're going to renew it every year? Like, I can't make myself always remember every year, every December, November, oh, I got to call Select to get a new bond, you know. So I said, we got to figure out some way to put the onus back on them to get us back the bond. So he came up with this way of amending, doing an administrative change to the special permit to just tweak the condition, number 6, and he provided the language that was in front of you tonight that talks about that they required to provide the bond before the next one expires, the new one, the current one expires, but they always have to have one in place. So that's where that came from. So they have already supplied us with one bond that's good until the end of next calendar year. And they have an agreement to, they've written an agreement that they will live with whatever condition we established. They've looked at this condition and are happy with it. This is what town council provided. So that's kind of where we're at with that. If you have any specific questions, I can try to answer them as best I can. Ken was on a conference call with town council and myself, and you know, so he knows a little bit about it too. I don't know if there's anything more that you need. No.
I think, you know, I think it was a reasonable compromise to, you know, protect the town. It's also interesting that the piece of property is for sale now, with or without the solar panels.
Yeah, we found that out after the fact.
Oh, really?
The property's now for sale. But
Yeah. And I don't know whether, so if you want to buy a solar farm, I guess.
The house and the solar farm are for sale together.
Right. So it's
potential solar farm, right?
Got a building permit today, so.
Got a building permit already.
Right.
Based on
I
this.
I have a question, John.
Yeah.
The bond, there's a value for the bond, obviously.
Yeah, so we agreed to a $45,000 bond.
Okay. Now, as the years go by, that price might increase. Is it possible that this could have an escalation in it? Would
so
we would get the money back?
We did do a 2% inflation on the original bond, so originally, like, today's cost would be less than that.
So it's
25,
it's 2% per year, will go up?
No, so
45 is what we think, if you add 2% inflation over 20 years.
What would be?
Oh, so you already added it.
Yeah,
okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I wanted to
correct.
Know.
Correct.
Yeah.
So that,
yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, quite frankly, from a town standpoint, I mean, if this thing was kind of really out there in the middle of everything, we'd be more concerned. I mean, you're not going to be able to see very much of this from the street standpoint, and I would think that the owner of the property is going to be much more, if it's gone and Select is out of there or whatever, they're going to be much more interested in getting this thing out of their backyard, as opposed to, you know, I mean, but it'll protect, I'll say, the two immediate neighbors that kind of have a view of it, so. I think it's a good compromise. So first of all, I'm going to consider a vote to consider this an administrative change. We are just barely tweaking one condition. Look for a motion to consider it as an administrative change.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
Discussion item, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
What's the difference between an administrative item and whatever the next level?
We would have to have a public hearing. And, you know, inform the neighbors, et cetera.
Okay.
Basically, the way I looked at it is we were requiring a bond.
Anyway.
So that part is there. We're just altering the form of the bond.
So that's
okay.
Just clarification.
Okay.
I checked with council and agrees that it's an administrative change. He did not feel it was a major in nature.
And if they default? At the end of a year, does it stay in force?
So then it would be a zoning enforcement action by the building commissioner, because I did ask that question to council, what will we do? Like, turn off the power?
I know,
like,
what do you do,
So it would be a zoning enforcement. The building director of municipal inspections would have to, the zoning enforcement officer would have to issue an enforcement order, and then it would take that route. I guess ultimately, if they refuse to, usually if someone hits a company like Select with the zoning enforcement, they're going to then respond and do what they're supposed to do because they don't want to follow through and take it to court. But ultimately, if it goes to court and they lose, ultimately their power gets turned off and their customers lose power. So I guess ultimately that would be the ultimate.
Yeah. And Select is also a good Hopkinton community, yeah. You know, based organization, local organization, and, you know,
yeah.
Reputable
organization. I can't imagine it ever getting to that level, but...
Yeah. So, okay, we have before this a vote to consider administrative change. Further discussion beyond? Seeing none, I think you're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone oppose? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, then I consider a vote to revise condition 6 of June 27, 2016 to the what you have in front of you today with the word I in there and the word in there in the fourth line that town council just missed one letter there. So I entertain a motion.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Second. Great. Okay. Further discussion? We're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, so that item is done. Now we're down to the item that we have put off for the last several busy meetings, which is good that we're getting to it. And we're talking about annual goals. And if you remember our discussion from the last time around, I was kind of asking everyone to consider which one each one of us might adopt or whatever, or maybe we decide we throw a couple of these out too. I mean, that's the other thing.
I nominate John for number 4.
Yeah. Okay, so let's just go down from the first one. The master plan update, basically that's kind of an all, but at this point I think, unless the public would completely reject what we had, we've already done all the heavy lifting on that one. So
did you want to take that out as a goal? Or?
No, because we haven't got
it's
it done
complete.
Yet.
Okay.
It's almost complete.
We hope. I mean, you know, by the way, there's all sorts of folks that there was a drought, Educate Hopkinton or whatever their new name is, had a seminar. They're publicizing it on their website that they had the meeting, they brought it up at the drought thing, and you know, so I think there's going to be more than one, two people come there. Maybe we'll get out of that meeting really relatively quick too, but who knows. Okay.
Is it here?
It's actually going to be in that room, 250.
Okay.
You mean our public hearing for our master plan?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be in 250. We switched to conservation that night.
That's 2 weeks from today, 21st?
Right. So, and we are not going to have any other hearings that night. If there is an A&R plan or something like, you know, miscellaneous stuff, we'll put that on the agenda. But other than that, we've got just that item.
Maybe minutes to approve.
Yeah, minutes and stuff. But, okay, downtown revitalization and parking. Does anyone have a great interest in this particular one? I mean, this is going to be kind of the year where I'm hoping that we get the 25% design review done with the state. And I would hope that you start really looking at more parking, because that's going to be, I think, critical to public acceptance of the plan at the end.
I'll take that one, since I'm eliminating the parking on the sidewalks.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, just a question on not just number 2, but I think the other ones is, I understand that these are goals. What are the action items required from each of us that take on one of these goals? What further analysis is?
That's a good question. I think it's up to the person that's going to be kind of the head guy, maybe working a little bit with the chairman or Jennifer, to kind of figure out what it's going to do so that maybe we do a better job of accomplishing more of them. I mean, we've kind of, not that it should make excuses, but we've kind of had the master plan update is the critical one, and as some of us were remarking before the meeting started, we'd been pretty well swamped, and this is one of the first times we've had a relatively light agenda, and, you know, we might have a few more of these, so we'll be emphasizing more of the goals as we go through. I mean, so I guess I'm saying is the person that's kind of there is to work with the staff, Lane, et cetera, or whoever, to see what we can do to help the process, I guess.
What I would think is, like you said, help identify maybe some next steps, mm-hmm. and then maybe people involved in that, or, you know, boards involved in that. And
I think clearly one of the things, David, is to try to identify and maybe work with some additional resources, because we individually probably don't have much pull on some of these things, but we may be able to reach out to other folks mm-hmm. in order to actually have some meaningful dialogue and involve on some of these.
A lot of this might be just trying to build up consensuses to get things done, or, you know, I could see, like, on the Hayden Rowe corridor study, you know, use some of our engineering resources to scope the problem, you know, so that we would know what the capital request would be to do an engineering study from there to there. I mean, you know, be working with, say, Beta or whatever, or Beta and somebody else, or Beta and the town engineer, and DPW. Well, anyway. Okay, so John, you've taken on two. Now we're on three. That Hayden Rowe, who's interested in this one?
I'll take that one.
You know a lot about it, right?
And
you,
well, I live off that
street. You live off that street. Well, you know about the traffic flows, and it'll be a good fit for you.
I certainly do.
Okay. And parking on sidewalks, I think we'd already given that one to John, because he's already working on it.
We'll have something in the first meeting in December.
Great. And, you know, that just reminds me, anytime anyone wants to get something on the agenda, you know, call Jennifer, call myself. We're pretty flexible about that. It's only if we...
Just remember our Tuesday deadline.
Oh, it applies to us, too?
No exceptions.
It applies to us?
No exceptions.
Yeah. Okay. Parking and sidewalk. It's John. Sidewalk connectivity in bike lanes, which is a lot of, you know, bike lanes is going to be part of the downtown revitalization. Sidewalk connectivity is part of that. You know, we have a trails committee. Maybe, you know, part of it is ends up being liaison to some of these other stuff, which, you know, I'm not trying to provide solutions. It's just kind of.
I would be up for that if nobody else wants to.
Okay. Right.
We have a couple members missing too that might want to jump
we'll
in.
We'll assign them the lousy ones.
There are no lousy ones.
They're all good.
Okay. Six. Engage major landowners and business owners. I'll be happy to take that one on.
Go for it.
We're just going to basically look at anyone that's got a big piece of empty land or big piece of business land, just to make sure that they understand that you got a planning board that's here to help them or
can
work
I be combined
with them.
With
six
ten?
And ten, I was just going to say, does six and ten kind of lend itself
together? You mean?
Yeah, you got one. It's a large land.
Sure.
The other is a large parcel.
Yep, we can combine those two.
Maybe we should get it down to nine goals, so everybody has one. Like John, did John already take two? No.
Okay. Let's go to the public-private roads. I think I probably put it on there originally. It's really probably to try to frame a debate. It's public-private. Well, we've kind of fixed a lot of the private roads, but you know, we're seeing it with the street that we
Elsinore
Drive. You know, maybe we have to internally kind of logically put together, rethink our policy is what I'm thinking is a goal. And you know, just somebody that wants to kind of.
I'll take it.
Okay, great.
I can forward you a list, Brian. I already asked Elaine for a list of private streets, and she's got the whole list of all
great.
The streets. So
thanks.
We added a column there for private.
Saves me a phone call or email.
Yeah.
Okay. Lumber Street, West Main Street, we've really gotten ourselves at a standstill at this point just because we haven't gotten the engineer on board, and I don't know where that is.
Who's paying for that, Ken?
We actually have money that we got from the mitigation money. We don't have enough money to do the full construction project, but we have enough to get the engineering, which will then tell us how much we need to go to somebody else to get the money. And also, part of the Muse mitigation, I believe they ended up, Muse, I think they have, the Selectmen have $1 million worth of mitigation on that. We got, what was it, 70 or 80,000 or 100,000, maybe it was 100,000, it was half of what we thought the road would take to be built. Yeah.
So can you back up for a second?
Sure.
The Selectmen have $1 billion to do exactly what?
To mitigate the Muse project. And mitigate is, it's open-ended.
Intersection falls within that.
Intersection would definitely fall in there. To me, you know, to me, it's one of the easiest causes and effects. They're the one that created the problem, and
right.
You know, but the Selectmen might be thinking that they're going to use that money for undergrounding utilities in downtown.
Selectmen have the decision-making power with that money, though. So
well, that's why we would have to convince them, or
right. But I just don't want David to think that. Or can use that money for the intersection.
I had some other ideas for it. My thought, and it's probably not a reasonable thought, but it just came to me anyway, is that if we have to put in that turning lane and we have to move the utility poles over and rewire everything, why don't we just put that little section underground? I know that would probably be a lot more expensive, but at least get them priced both ways, see what the difference is.
I think your assumption that it would be more expensive is correct,
yes.
But on the other hand, it's not... It's not. It's
digging up already.
It certainly make it look a lot better.
And is that something that the $1 million can be utilized for?
We don't know.
$1 million could be used for that, or you know, or once we get the estimate, we submit a capital request, you know, to town meeting. I really wanted to get it done this year.
Right.
I'll be happy to keep trying to go on that and spend some time on it over the next month.
So Cliff kind of nicknamed that section Claflinville.
Yep.
And regardless of the name, whatever, I think that's becoming, obviously it has traffic issues, but I think it's becoming a nice little area for, you know, retail and restaurants and stuff. So it's almost like a little mini downtown. Like if we're looking at undergrounding downtown in a few years, we should think about that area as well.
What is happening with that lot?
Cliff lived right there, too.
Yeah. On the corner of...
Maybe a few more years. He's talking about selling.
Is that Elm or is that Lumber Street?
The one right next to where the Dunkin' Donuts was?
Yeah. That's when that house got leveled.
Is it too small to put anything? Is that why nothing's happening?
It's too expensive for what the land is. That's what I heard.
The owner wants too much.
The owner wants too much money.
What's that?
Talking about the vacant land on the other.
Yeah, I was just saying the same thing to these guys.
Yeah. But maybe I'll ask Cliff if he wants to work on that one.
I have a feeling you're going to say that. My only thought about that is he's in a butter.
Yeah,
and
maybe that's
not. Would not be the best solution.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Utility pole legislation.
Is that the idea that you had to get it moving faster, right?
Yes, and I got an email from our representative Carolyn Dykema, on double pole legislation. But it was getting rid of the double poles, which I haven't seen a double pole come down in years. I mean, they just keep
the permanent fixture.
Keep, you know.
Waiting for the first triple pole.
It's, and I'll tell you, Roy's, you know, Legacy North still does not have power to it. I mean.
Oh, I thought.
They got the poles, the new poles sitting there, they got wires and pulleys to string the wires, and they didn't, you know.
Oh, I thought that was all done.
I saw that.
And that has been what? close to 18 months at this point?
18 months.
18 months.
Right in the corner of Franklin?
Yep. I mean, at least the pole is out of the middle of the street at this point.
Yeah,
but they have not worked on it now for like 2 or 3 months.
So is this a relationship thing with Eversource?
I think part of the deal is, well, when InStar owned it, or Boston Edison, the guy that Boston Edison, the president of that, he's since gone. From what I understand, he just cut costs wherever he could cut costs. So he got rid of all of his crews. And this is a tough union job to do it where they don't get much work per, you know, I've watched them a couple of days, and Roy has, I think, pointed out what he's watched them a couple of days, and, you know, if they get 3 hours of work out of a crew in a day, I mean,
some impromptu line time study is
and so anyway, it's coupled with, you know, and then you've got the DPU that regulates electrical rates, and they want to keep the rates as low as they can down. So it's a tougher situation. I mean, I think at the end of the day, it might be legislation is the only way it's going to get solved, and that's why I was kind of asking the representative what was going on.
Did she have any input? Or?
I got a piece of legislation. I'm not sure whether it was the Representative Walsh from Framingham. He did something on similar to this, I think. I saw it, read it in the paper. And, you know, the Eversource, Boston Edison, they have quite a lobby force. They didn't skimp on that. They skimping on the guys
work,
that
the
actually
workers.
Do the work, but
not the lobbyists.
And so they, and particularly the DPU, they, you know, we've had, the town's had a couple actions through there, and we always come out at the end, the short end. So
I'll try to take this on.
Okay.
I'm not sure.
I will be happy to help you
what can
on
be done?
Some of this.
But I have a hair with these guys anyway, so I'm happy to agenda.
Well, it's just a shame that you're trying to grow, and it takes a year and a half to put the utilities in. I mean, it's ridiculous.
We've been trying to get power with these guys for literally for 6 months, and they haven't turned the lights on over there yet. So I'm more than happy to go spit some fire at these guys.
Is this new lights? Or?
No, the existing lights. Somebody shut them off 6 months ago. Nobody's come out to fix them.
Yes.
So I'm ready to kind of take these guys on.
Okay. And so we've got, okay, good.
Excellent.
I'll help you on whatever.
Absolutely.
I can. And the last one, I think, is the guardrail standards, and I think that one is yours.
I suggested it. I'm willing to follow up on it, but I don't know if somebody else needs, does anybody want a goal, or?
Matt, what are you going to do? Which one?
I can do the guardrails.
Okay.
Who is doing number 8?
I ended up with that one. Okay. But I will be willing to take help if anyone.
Well, Frank didn't get one.
Well, I was thinking, Ken, that you might be good just supporting all these instead of owning one.
Well, we'll see. If I can get rid of it, I will. I
would just say that Cliff would not be a good one to take number 8, but
that's probably. Yeah, I don't know. I'm going to use some engineering skills on this one, but I think a lot of the work is actually going to be was being done a little bit by the town engineer, but he got frustrated. He just couldn't get.
Frank and Cliff could help you with 6 and 10, maybe. Or maybe not.
I don't know. We'll let them come in.
They could help in many places.
Yeah. Okay. I think we're all set, and on that one, street acceptance discussion. I think I added that to the agenda because somebody was saying, and I think it's in her note, these are potential streets for next May. The Cold Spring Road, Pine Tree Lane, Cedar Mill Road, and I think the first three are part of the plan to get older streets done.
That's correct.
Since we talked to El Segundo Road, have anyone heard anything about that?
I have not. I know that Mr. Osceola had called Elaine late last week, but I did not follow back up with her to see what that conversation was like.
Okay.
So I'm not.
She's going to send it back to you.
She's going to send it back to me. Okay. So I guess she's sending him back to me.
Okay. Well, that one might be on the list. I'm not sure whether Cranberry Lane is going to make it. I think
what's
they.
Cranberry Lane.
That's. Oh wait, which one is that?
I don't know. Cranberry.
That's not the one off.
That's
not Westcott. I think Cranberry Cove is Westcott, yeah. So I get
correct.
Mixed up with that.
Cranberry Lane is off of South Mill. Isn't that the one where Ron Nation just rebuilt for us?
That's Penny Meadow.
Oh, okay. Never mind. Then Cranberry Lane is right the next one up from that, and
okay.
I think that's in the category of the first four.
So Cranberry Lane is off of South Mill.
Yep.
Okay. So there's
okay.
only like four lots, five lots.
Right. And then Legacy South, I don't think we're making it based on Roy McDowell's discussion before, so that's probably not going to make it. In Cobbler's Way.
I did talk to Brian Gassett. He is going to be ready for May.
Okay.
He's going to pave it in like April instead of March or April.
Cobbler's.
Okay.
I talked to him on Friday.
Legacy
great.
South. You're talking about Legacy South, right?
No.
No, Cobbler's.
Oh, Cobbler's Way?
Where is Cobbler's Way?
Yeah. Oh, Cobbler's Street.
Front Street.
Front Street.
Those are big homes.
Those are big
yeah.
Brian,
mansions.
Yes, yeah.
They're all $1 million homes.
Brian
yeah.
Gassett.
They're big mansions.
Yeah, maybe.
They still have two or three that they haven't built yet, right?
Ready front.
They've done a blank. We haven't seen that, right? Yeah. So
yeah.
It's
maybe
right down by
so Elaine had also, I didn't know if the board had any other streets they had thought might be ready for acceptance.
I still can't believe that the guy up there in Highland 4 or whatever is still working on that street and hasn't asked for a lot release.
Mm-hmm. Talking about the Stonegate one?
No.
Singletary.
Well,
Singletary.
Yeah.
No.
You mean the new street in Highland Park 4?
Yeah.
Yeah,
connector?
Isn't it Stonegate or Stonegate?
Yeah. Stony Brook.
Stony Brook.
I thought it was Singletary.
No.
That's a little couple of houses in the
cul-de-sac.
Yeah.
Oh. It's old.
It's the extension, really, of Stony Brook.
I can't believe it's. I mean, he's got millions invested in that street, but whatever.
Apparently, he has millions.
It's going
to
be very expensive real estate, I think.
Yeah.
Maybe he just doesn't want to bond it.
I don't know.
It seems like they're gradually building the stone wall, finishing up the stone wall on it.
They're close. They're working on that last stone wall that we made them not make it a concrete wall.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it is what it is.
Why
would
they put a concrete wall on there when all the rest of them are so nice in Highland Park?
Well, that's what this board told them.
Right, I know.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we're all set on that. That was just kind of an information type thing.
Right.
Approved minutes. Any comments, questions for minutes for September 26, 2016? If nobody had any problems with the minutes, then I look for a motion to approve.
Motion to approve.
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Let's see. On future agenda items and stuff, we kind of talked about the Lumber Street left-hand turn, and I think we want to kind of add to that is left... whether the signal gets a left turn lane. So basically the left turn lane that does the signal itself get changed as part of, you know, we have that new left turn lane that goes on to Lumber Street South from
mm-hmm.
Main Street or West Main Street going west.
Yeah.
Does that signal get a left hand turn lane? So that's
well,
an action for
depend on what the traffic study
well, said. And I'm saying I think
and
there
we
might
just got an updated report from them, so I can check.
Okay, that was the one question that we'll want to talk about in the future. In Legacy Farms Road North, I noticed that there was a whole crew working on the bridge today. So they're making some progress on the last little link of the sidewalk, and there was a crew from the construction firm getting rid of piles of rock and stuff that was done.
I don't know when they did it, but they also cut down all the grass between the sidewalk and everything. It looks fairly decent.
Yeah. And then there's also a crew out there putting gas lines up along the top of the hill. Okay. So that's
gearing up for starting the North Villages. We had a construction meeting last week, so they're probably going to start in a few weeks.
They put the sign, Duval and Wilson, they put the sign down there, and there's stop signs on Legacy North, the road that goes through. It's going to cut through. Can we talk about having four stop signs there?
We did. I sent that letter to the Board of Selectmen. I'm not sure if it got to their packages yet or not.
I think it was in their packages already. Okay. Can you find out from us, for us at our next meeting, as to what the Selectmen decided to do?
Yep.
I think they meet after us the next meeting.
No, that was already on there.
Okay.
That was on their agenda already.
Okay, I'll find out.
And I was told, don't bother to come. That seems to be simple. So
okay.
I said, okay.
We missed you at the school.
I was at the drought meeting. That's a good segue. The drought meeting, we've got another Water Resources Commission, which is the state job that I got on Thursday. But the drought has eased a little bit, but it will take many, many months of good rainfall to recover from where it is. It usually takes 2 to 3 times to get out of a drought than it takes you to get into it. And, you know, we started this drought period with low snow fall last winter, and so this last month we had a couple of really great rains, and then filled up Ice House Pond like overnight and a few other things like that. But it's going to take a lot more before we get into that area. Early December, we've gotten plans for a small waiting room addition to the dental office on Hayden Rowe Street. So that'll be coming up. Not a big, major, significant plan.
It's a minor site plan change, but they need zoning approval first.
Yep, so that's what they've been holding off. And then tomorrow, I got invited to an Eversource meeting. They have 3 or 4 projects besides the LNG plant modernization that are going on potentially around there. They're looking at a solar farm on Rafferty Road. As all the board members remember, the neighborhood folks were upset with us when we were cutting a few trees down on Rafferty Road. Well, they want to take and make 22 acres of solar panels. So it's bigger than the one that was going to be on East Main Street.
So it'll be on the north side of
Rafferty? On the north side of Rafferty.
I hate it when they take down trees to make a solar farm. We have all these roofs.
This is a lot of trees.
It's like 17 acres.
No, 22. Because it was 17
then
was
the other section.
And there's five acres that are right next to the dog.
I was gonna say right to the animal shelter.
Right, I mean maybe part of where they're parking. I mean it was
literally
it
from the road, almost from Wilson Street all the way down.
Yeah,
but there's a big there's a big gap in between.
There's a wet area in the middle.
It goes pretty far back from the road on one section, and then down by the dog shelter, there's
just a small section. It's 5 acres.
On which side? Opposite?
North side.
So is this abutting the state park?
A little bit.
Yeah.
So let's wipe out everything next to the state park.
Tough to get over that. But if you're on a boat,
that may be the best place for it. But what can you do? There's no recourse.
Well, one of the concerns that I have is, remember, our consultant explained that having trees made a vapor release significantly better.
Yeah.
And, you know, he wanted to keep all the trees right around it. And I'm going to plan to bring that up tomorrow. And if they were to take all the trees down, then I would think that they would need to mitigate the safety issue, which might be extending lanterns down around that side of the around. I mean, I don't really like that many acres of trees coming down, quite frankly, but we'll hear more about that project tomorrow.
Apparently a lot of people have been saying because all the trees that came down with the school, there's a lot of foxes and deer and everything running around town.
Sure. Oh, really? Yeah.
I'm sure. Anytime you take down that many trees, you're going to have wildlife everywhere.
Well, I notice behind me, I've got a lot of legacy deer and, you know, everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, because there is a corridor right there.
Turkeys and everything.
Yeah, we had five deer in the backyard the other day, which was kind of neat. Okay, so that's kind of all what I've got on.
Can I just, so in your package was the 2017 schedule for your information. It was, you know, sticking with the second and fourth Monday of the month. If anybody had any issues with that. So just as an FYI.
We're not meeting during school vacation week, right?
I don't believe so, but I will double check.
I mean, that would be the only concern, you know, the February school vacation week is going to be a vacation week.
Oh, no, you're definitely not, because you're meeting the week I'm on vacation, and I'm not on vacation, school vacation week.
Okay.
I think the 18th.
It's usually that.
I think school vacation week
is. It starts the 20th of February.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're meeting the 13th.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or the 14th.
When is town meeting?
You're not meeting the week of town meeting.
I mean,
it's the first.
It's the second
Monday,
May 2nd, whatever that is
you're
meeting there next.
It must be the first.
Yeah.
I have one question. In the packet, there was the public hearing for the Board of Appeals. It's just for...
Just FYI, they send you all their notices.
We have to.
If we're free that evening, we can back up.
Sure.
If you were interested.
and just again, for those who didn't hear me last time, I will not be at your next meeting. And I wrote it in your memo. But Elaine will be there. So.
Just make sure you watch the video.
I'll be in Florida. I don't think I get the video in Florida.
You'll be back.
Do you want to post it in?
Last thing for preparation. Are we going to have some drafts of the plan available for this hearing?
I'm sure we can.
I mean, we probably got to kill a couple more trees and print up.
Yeah, I'll print a bunch of copies, and I mean, it'll be attached to the agenda that gets posted to.
Sure.
And then will all of you want new copies?
Yeah, I think we need to have the latest and greatest to make sure we've got it. And, you know, particularly those, and maybe you can remind me in a piece of paper, who wrote which chapters. So those people that wrote that chapter, if we get a piece of comment from the public, you're going to be on the hook.
Yeah.
And, you know.
I think Elaine has that. I don't have that information, but I think Elaine does, so.
Yeah. Well, anyway, most of you got noticed, so make sure you read your chapter.
The new guys are all set. We didn't participate.
Yeah, we didn't write
any. Oh, that's true.
So there's...
You'll have to take the one that Claire wrote.
Oh, jeez. So, question, Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
On the online version here, there's a couple of letters. I don't know if they're old or future, but letter to John Westerman about sidewalks and letter to Boris Luckman about Hayden Rowe Corridor.
Yes, we sent John Western.
Those went out.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're looking at an old agenda.
Yeah, okay.
You're a week behind,
it's,
I think.
Well, it's always a mix. It's kind of weird. It's got all the 45 South Street in it.
Oh, okay.
It's got some older stuff, too. It's hard to tell.
Okay.
It's
well, I'm getting you out of here before 9 today.
Awesome.
And which is really great.
We have to rest up so we can have enough energy to vote tomorrow.
Absolutely. Vote early and often.
Did everybody already vote? Did anybody already vote? I just am amazed that all these states have been rejecting fact that you have to have a photo ID to vote. What, poor people can't have a photo ID? I don't understand discrimination.
Well, most people I do have a photo ID to either buy booze or buy an airline ticket.
It is considered discrimination to require someone to have a photo ID to vote.
Which was the first part of that?
It is considered discrimination.
I know, but why?
Because it's a right. You shouldn't have to have a photo ID to vote.
Therefore, you can vote seven times.
Yeah. Okay. Look for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
So second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Good job.